Your third stream, double your money in the market, how to multiply your investment dollars. In the last few chapters, we have talked about how to invest 80% of your investment mountain dollars into long and intermediate term investments, such as index funds, aggressive mutual funds, and stocks. In this chapter, I'll show you where I believe some of the remaining 20% of your dollars should go. This is your most aggressive portfolio. To do this, we'll shorten our time frame, narrow our focus, and, hopefully, double our money. Yes, there are ways to double your money in the market, if you're willing to take some extra risks and employ the power of leverage. Leverage. Interesting word. What does it mean? The root word is lever. Archimedes, the Greek genius who lived about 200 BC, discovered that with levers and pulleys, he could move huge objects with a small amount of force. He is said to have boasted, "Give me the place to stand, and a lever long enough, and I will move the earth." Leverage in the financial world means controlling a large amount of wealth with a small amount of money. How does leverage work? First, we'll look at a real estate example, then the stock market. Let's assume that two families buy their first $100,000 home. Mr. and Mrs. Cash use a $100,000 inheritance and pay cash for their home. Mr. and Mrs. Leverage put down $10,000 and arrange for a $90,000 mortgage. Let's assume that both homes appreciate $5,000 in value almost immediately. The Cash family earns a return on their investment of 5%. $5,000 divided by $100,000 equals 5% profit. The Leverage family has the power of leverage on its side. Since they invested only $10,000, the return on their investment is 50%. $5,000 divided by $10,000 equals 50% profit. Of course, prices could decline and then leverage would work in reverse. But because real estate prices tend to increase over the long term, most homeowners end up with long-term gains. The power of leverage gives the beginning investor the ability to control a lot of real estate with only a small amount of money. The power of leverage employed with the stable nature of real estate is a long-term surefire winner. It is, without question, the reason that a large percentage of the personal wealth in the world is accumulated in the average family's single-family home. Can you apply leverage to the stock market? Absolutely. Any stock investor using his or her stock as collateral can borrow up to 50% of the value of the stock to buy more stock. This is called buying on margin. The problem with buying individual stocks on margin is that, unlike real estate, stocks are volatile. That is, stocks often show wide swings in price over a short time span. Real estate is generally exempted from this degree of volatility. In the short term, this volatility in stocks can be very dangerous to your wealth. It's like betting your rent money on the spin of the roulette wheel. However, the use of leverage in the stock market can be very powerful. In Chapter 6, we talked about several ways to multiply your rate of return by using enhanced index funds. In this chapter, I'll share with you another way to use leverage in the stock market that, if used with prudence, can produce spectacular returns. Let me return to real estate to provide an example. In the beginning of my real estate investing experience, I stumbled onto a technique that made a nice profit for me. I was learning the ropes of real estate investing by working as a licensed real estate agent. My boss was a real estate appraiser named Paul Brown. One day, a client came in to request an appraisal on a 4-acre piece of vacant ground. As he was leaving, he stopped to chat and mentioned the following details. The land had been donated to a local church many years earlier, when the property was nothing but a cow pasture. In the ensuing years, development had cropped up around the pasture, and its value has significantly appreciated. The church was in no hurry to sell the property and just wanted to determine its approximate value. The man hinted that the church might be willing to sell an option on the property. "What's an option?" I asked. He explained it to me this way. Suppose your boss appraises this property today at $200,000. The church has two choices. It can list the property with a realtor for $200,000 and wait for an offer. Suppose several months go by and someone offers us $200,000. After commissions of about $12,000, we'll net about $188,000. That's the first choice. The second choice would be to sell an option on the property. Suppose an investor wants to give us $10,000 for the right to lock in the price for a year at $200,000. If this investor is able to sell the property to someone else for more than $210,000, then they get to keep the difference as a profit. How does the church win? It gets a full $200,000 in cash, plus the option money of $10,000. And it doesn't have to pay a penny in commissions. Obviously, this is a win-win situation. I was intrigued, but skeptical. We parted company, but I continued to stew over the numbers. As an agent, I had been trained to have sellers give me a listing. But this seller wanted me to pay him $10,000 up front. If I couldn't sell it, I'd lose everything. It seemed extremely risky, but I had a powerful hunch to move forward. I went to visit the gentleman and made one of the most fateful decisions of my life. I told him that I didn't have $10,000, but that I would give him $5,000 if he would lock in a price at $200,000 for 1 year. After a moment's thought, he agreed. We shook on it and I left. There was only one problem. I didn't have the $5,000 and I didn't know where I could get it. Again on a hunch, I took a dentist friend over to look at the property. I told him that if he put up the money, I would handle finding a buyer. He didn't have $5,000 either, but he thought he could borrow it from his banker. So we formed a partnership. He would come up with the money and I would guarantee him a 100% profit if there was a profit, or I would guarantee to pay his loan to the bank if things didn't pan out. A few days later, when I signed my name to that option, I knew my neck was really on the line. If I couldn't move the property, I would be stuck for the entire $5,000 loss. To my great relief, 11 months later, I found a builder who was looking for just such a property on which to build an apartment building. He offered $275,000 in cash. I readily accepted. At the closing, the church received its $200,000 in cash. My dentist friend received $12,000, which paid back his bank loan and put a nice profit into his pocket. After costs, my broker and I split the remaining $60,000 in cash. I was still single, so I took my $30,000 profit, bought a VW bus in Germany, and toured Europe with a couple of buddies. Everybody won. The church made more money than it would have by listing the property for sale. My partner doubled his money. And instead of a small commission, I made a $30,000 fee for taking the risk and putting the transaction together. This was my first exposure to options. When it comes to the stock market, the concept of options is exactly the same. Some owners of stock are willing to sell an option on their stock for a fee. The seller of the option gets immediate income from the sale of the option, and the buyer of the option gets the right, but not the obligation, to buy the stock at a future date at a fixed price. If the stock increases in value enough, the person who bought the option can profit. If the stock doesn't increase in value on or before a future date, the option expires and the money is lost. Sounds risky, and it is. But just as in my real estate example, if you play your cards right, you can win, and win big. Profit multiplier 1. Writing covered calls. To show you how this works, let's pretend that you are a long-term employee of XYZ Company. In your company retirement plan, you have accumulated 1,000 shares of XYZ stock over the years. Each share is worth $6, so your portfolio is worth $6,000. Every month, you've been accumulating stock tax-free, dollar-cost averaging like the millionaire next door, with no intention whatsoever of selling your stock. You're happy to let it compound away till retirement day. But then one day, your stockbroker, in reviewing your financial statement, sees that you own 1,000 shares of XYZ at $6 a share. She asks you if you might consider writing some covered calls. Covered what, you ask? She explains that because you own the stock, you can sell an option to someone else and earn some immediate short-term income. She tells you that people are willing to give you 50 cents a share today for the right to buy a 30, 60, or 90-day call option at $7 a share. That could generate $500 in income immediately. 1,000 shares times 50 cents equals $500. Since these short-term gains occur in your tax-sheltered retirement account, you can defer the tax consequences. Why should I consider such a plan, you ask? Well, the obvious benefit, she explains, is that instead of just letting your stock sit there earning dividends, you could earn extra money on the same stock by selling an option against it. If someone is willing to give you $500 immediately for the option, you can earn an immediate 8.3% on your money. $500 divided by $6,000 equals 8.3%. You don't have to wait an entire year as you do with a CD or a bond. The money is deposited the very next day into your brokerage account. You make an instant $500. Wait a minute. There must be a catch somewhere. Why would anybody do that? Well, suppose the person, let's call him Tom, buying the option has a strong belief that XYZ stock is going to increase in value substantially in the next 30 days. He thinks it might go to $8 per share. Acting on this belief, he could do one of two things. 1. Tom could buy 1,000 shares of the stock today for $6,000 and hold on for 30 days. If it goes up to $8 per share, he could sell out and reap a $2 profit per share, or $2,000 less commissions. That would be a quick 33% on his money in 30 days. Not bad. But what's the downside? Suppose the stock declines to $5 per share or lower. That would wipe out $1,000 or more of value. By buying the stock, Tom could make $2,000 or more on the upside, and on the downside, he might lose $1,000 or more. Is there another way? Number 2. Suppose instead of paying $6,000 to buy the stock, the investor buys an option on 1,000 shares of stock with a locked-in price of $7. The cost would be $500. With leverage, Tom controls $6,000 worth of stock for only $500. If the stock goes up to $8 a share, then he could exercise his option, sell the 1,000 shares for $8,000, pay you $7,000, and pocket $1,000 for himself. Of course, he invested $500 to buy the option, so his net profit is $500. Notice how leverage doubled the return on Tom's investment. A $500 investment returned a $500 profit, or 100% on his money, in only 30 days. But wait, what's the downside? Well, if the stock doesn't increase in value in 30 days, the option expires worthless and our investor Tom loses the entire $500. Poof, up in smoke. Why would Tom take such a risk? 3 reasons. 1, maybe he doesn't have the $6,000 to buy 1,000 shares of XYZ, but wants to take advantage of a potential upward movement in the stock. 2, maybe he doesn't want to put $6,000 of his money at risk where there is a chance the stock could lose more than $1,000 if things didn't turn out. 3, or maybe he wants to have a chance of earning huge rates of return, 50% or more on his money. For whatever reasons, there are thousands of Toms out there who are willing to assume this risk. I'll show you how to find them shortly. Now a little terminology is in order. One option contract controls 100 shares of stock. 10 contracts would, therefore, control 1,000 shares of stock. In the preceding example, Tom would have bought 10 option contracts. There are 2 kinds of options, calls and puts. In our example, Tom bought a call option, the right to buy, or call, a specific stock at a specific price. Investors buy calls when they expect the price of the underlying stock to go up. A put price is the exact opposite, the right to sell a specific stock at a specific price. Investors generally buy puts when they expect the underlying price of the stock to go down. In this book, I will be talking only about call options. The $7 price that Tom locks in for XYZ stock is called the strike price, and the $500 Tom paid for the option is called a premium. All option contracts expire on the third Friday of every month. If you are buying a September call contract, you need to understand that the option expires on the third Friday of September. If Tom calls his broker in August and wants to buy 10 contracts with a strike price of $7 that will expire in about 30 days, he will say something like this. I'd like to buy 10 contracts of XYZ September $7 calls. He is informed that the premium is 50 cents per share, or a total of $500. If the stock increases in value beyond $7.50, he could earn a nice profit. Now, where do you fit into this picture? In our example, you own 1,000 shares of XYZ. You are willing to sell or write call options on your shares to magnify your return. You phone your broker and say something like this. I want to write 10 contracts on XYZ September $7 calls. The broker enters the order, sells the option contracts, and deposits the money, minus a small commission, into your account the next day. Here's the picture on the day you sell the option contracts to Tom. You own 1,000 shares of stock. Tom, he wants the option to buy your 1,000 shares. You sell, right, 10 call contracts. He buys 10 call contracts. You receive $500 in 24 hours. He invests $500. You earn an immediate 8.3%. He waits to see what the stock will do. Let's look at three possible scenarios in 30 days. Scenario 1. Your $6 stock appreciates in value to $8. You get called out. Tom. He exercises his option. You have to sell your stock to Tom for $7 a share. He buys your stock for $7 a share. You receive $7,000 cash from the stock sale. He resells it immediately for $8. You make $1,000 profit from the sale of the stock. He makes $1,000 from the sale of the stock. You keep the $500 from the sale of the option. He deducts the $500 cost of the option. Your total profit is $1,500, or 25%. His total profit is $500, or 100%. If you had held your stock instead of selling the options, your portfolio would now be worth $8,000. But since you sold the option and collected the $500 premium, you gave up your right to the fast price appreciation. Why did you do this? You decided that a bird in the hand was worth two in the bush. So you're happy with your decision. Everybody wins. Scenario 2. The stock price remains at about $6. You. The options you sold expire. Tom. His option contracts expire worthless. You have no more obligation to sell your stock. He loses his entire $500 premium. You earned $500, or 8.3% on your $6,000. His loss is 100%. You are free to repeat this process. Tom, oh well, better luck next time. With the right stock, you could do this several times a year and add an extra 10 to 50% return on your existing portfolio. Scenario 3. The stock price declines below $6. The result is exactly like Scenario 2. Since you're buying this stock to hold for the long term, you don't mind the short-term fluctuations up or down. You're like Warren Buffett. You just continue to buy and hold. In other words, you and Tom are betting against each other. If Tom wins, he pockets the short-term profit. If you win, you pocket the premium. So why would you be willing to play this game? Here's the secret. According to some experts, the options expire worthless about 80% of the time. You pocket the premium 8 out of 10 times. Suppose you were to play roulette with those odds. 80% of the time you win, and 20% you lose. How soon would you like to start? Still, there is risk. If the stock increases substantially above the strike price, you lose the potential profit. You still make some of the profit plus your premium, but the big profit goes to the person who buys your option. But remember, this doesn't happen very often. Most of the time, even if you lose, you don't lose much. And if you win, you win instantly. The only reason you might not want to play is if you were certain that the stock would really increase dramatically in price that month. This is the perfect scenario for a person who already owns stocks and plans to keep them. You sell an option when you want the opportunity to multiply your returns. I heard a rumor, whether true I don't know, that Warren Buffett made some substantial money by selling covered calls on his Coca-Cola stock. Perhaps this is one of the reasons he was able to make his fortune grow at over 22% compounded annual rate of return for 40 years in a row. What I just described is the technique of writing covered calls. To write and to sell mean the same thing. Covered means that you own the stock. What if you don't have 1,000 shares of XYZ just sitting around gathering dust so you can write some covered calls? Here's a plan for you. Let's say you have $10,000 in high-risk money that you want to invest. You realize that you could lose this money, but since you've already set up your survival basin and your long-term and intermediate investment basins, you're willing to assume more risk for a higher return. Your goal is to find the perfect stock to buy with the express intent of writing covered calls. You buy 1,000 shares of ABC stock at $9 per share for a total of $9,000. Then you sell 10 contracts of ABC $10 calls with an expiration date about 30 days in the future. The premium is 50 cents per share. You still own the stock, but you have sold the 30-day option, earning an extra $500, or an immediate 5.6% on your money. It is deposited into your brokerage account the very next day. Not bad for a one-day return. Now you have to wait for 30 days to find out what's going to happen. Will you be able to keep your nice profit, or will you lose some of the potential upside profit? Or will the stock decline in value? Let's review what could happen. Scenario 1. The stock increases in value to $11. Your stock gets called out at $10 per share, and you receive a check for $10,000. This gives you a profit of $1,000 plus the $500 premium on your calls. That's a tidy $1,500 in profit on your investment, or 16.6% in 1 month. What was your risk? You risk the lost profit that you might have earned above the $10 strike price. But as they say, a bird in the hand is worth two in a bush. Wouldn't you take a guaranteed 6.6% profit today over the slight chance that you might earn an even larger profit in 30 days? The answer is yes. Scenario 2. The stock hovers at around $9 per share for the entire 30 days. The option expires and you keep the $500 premium. You earn 5.6% on your money in 30 days. You can write another 10 calls the very next day and do the same thing all over again. Scenario 3. The stock drops to $8 per share. The option expires and you keep the $500 premium for your trouble. Your stock loses $1,000 in value, but the $500 option of premium hedges your loss. You lose a total of only $500 in 30 days, but you still own the stock. It might bounce back. In the best case, you make a sure $1,500 profit, but lose out on the chance to make a larger profit. In the next best case, you make a sure $500 profit. In the worst case, your stock loses $1,000 of its value, but your premium cuts your losses in half. So writing the covered calls was an excellent way to hedge your possible loss while giving you an excellent chance of earning a nice profit. It's the perfect strategy, and you could do this over and over and over again. Have I gotten your attention? If you were excited about the possibility of earning a long-term 11% a year in index funds, then the possibility of earning 5 to 25% a month or more should keep you awake at night. Well, now that I've gotten you excited, let's bring you back down to earth. What I have just described has been practiced for decades by a lot of very smart people, many of whom have lost a lot of money. If you're just a novice, you'd better go into this with your eyes open. What if you buy a stock that drops dramatically in value in those 30 days while you're waiting for the outcome? Your $5,000 nest egg could fall out of the carton and break. There are real risks associated with this strategy. You have to know what you're doing, or you will be another skeleton in the options graveyard. The goal is to win big when you win and lose small when you lose. The Cooper Covered Call Strategy. Well, it's time for you to learn how to do this. Let me teach you the Cooper Covered Call Strategy. Before we begin, remember that covered calls work best in a rising bull market. If you're in a bear market, don't even think of doing this strategy. Of the possible 10,000 stocks in the market, only about 2,000 of them are optionable. How do you determine whether a stock is optionable? Three ways. 1. Call your broker. 2. Go to www.cboe.com, which is the website of the Chicago Board Options Exchange, and click on the symbol directory. 3. See a listing of available options in the Wall Street Journal. Because 2,000 companies would be a formidable number to analyze, we need to screen only those stocks that have the probability of either maintaining their price, fluctuating in a narrow trading range, or increasing in value in 30 days. What criteria should we use? Dr. Cooper uses 5 screens that will filter out such stocks. Screen 1. We select only those stocks that are within 10% of their all-time high. Stocks that have either hit new highs, NH, or are within 10% of new highs are displayed in bold type in Investor's Business Daily. As you scan down the columns, they pop out easily. When you come to a boldface line, notice the column marked 52-week high. If you find the symbol NH next to the stock price, it means that the stock hit a new high that day. If only the stock price number is bold, it means that the stock is within 10% of its 52-week high. Screen 2. We eliminate all stocks that are priced above $25. Why $25? When you write covered calls, you need to buy the underlying stock. To get the best leverage, you need to sell at least 5 contracts. That's 500 shares. The cost of 500 shares at $50 per share is $25,000. Ouch! That's a lot of money. However, if you are dealing with a $10 stock, you can buy 500 shares for only $5,000. A much more manageable sum. In addition, the premium on a $75 stock for a 30-day option will be very similar to the premium for a $10 stock. You get more leverage with a cheaper stock. Because leverage is what we're looking for, stay below $25. Scan to the right to the closing price column. If the stock is higher than $25, eliminate the stock and keep scanning down until you reach the next NH symbol or bolded 52-week high price. Screen 3. Include only those stocks that have an earnings per share rank of 80+. You want to find stocks that, over the short term, are exhibiting a tendency to continue to increase in value. One of the best ways to predict a company whose stock price will increase is to watch for increased earnings. If earnings are increasing, the stock price should at least have some upward pressure, in theory. Investor's Business Daily actually tracks this static on the left side of the listing under the column marked Earnings Per Share. We are looking for stocks that have a high earnings per share in the 80th percentile. This means that 80% of all the companies listed have lower EPS growth than this stock does. This stock is in the top 20%. If you have come this far and the EPS number is not 80, eliminate the stock. Keep scanning down for the next NH or bold price and start all over again at screen 1. Screen 4. Include only those stocks that have a high relative strength figure of 80+. A high figure means that compared with all other stocks, this stock price is relatively strong. If you choose stocks with a relative strength of at least 80, you are sure that it is in the top 20% of the stocks in terms of price performance. Check the current stock to see if it has a number of 80 or more. If so, go to the next screen. Screen 5. Include only those stocks with a group strength of A. This compares the stock's industry group price performance over the past 6 months to the other 196 industry groups, oil, retailing, pharmaceuticals, gambling, etc. If your stock is marked A, it is in the top 20% of all industry groups. A high tide lifts all boats. Make sure that your stock is in a sector with a high tide. Once you have performed these screens, you will be left with a handful of possible candidates. This is your watch list. On the day in which I performed these screens in the Investor's Business Daily, only 3 stocks remained out of a universe of 2,000 worth. People in the stock world call this a fundamental analysis. It means that you are checking on a company's fundamentals, how well it is doing. The second major form of analysis is called technical analysis. Don't be intimidated by the word. It simply means analyzing a chart of the company's stock price to determine its pattern of behavior for the past 6 months. What do I mean by best looking? The most stable looking chart, the least number of big dips downward, the most steady march upward without huge spikes upward. How do we determine how much these options are going to sell for? 2 ways. 1. Call your stockbroker. 2. Look it up yourself on the internet. I think it's much more fun to look it up yourself, and then you can check with your broker to find out if you've done it right. Go to www.cboe.com. This is the website for the Chicago Board Options Exchange, the exchange that markets all of the listed options. Click on Delayed Quotes, then type in the symbol of your first stock choice and get a list of all call options. It will most likely be a bewildering list of numbers and columns that make perfect sense if you know what you're looking for and can give you instant headache if you don't. Let me show you what we're looking for. You'll notice that several months are listed. You want to find the month that is closest to 30 days from the month in which you are selling the option. Let's suppose that today is September 10th. You'd be looking for options that expire on the third Friday of October. Now that you have determined the month, let's determine the strike price. You'll notice that next to each month are various strike prices. January 5, January 7.5, January 10, etc. You are looking for a strike price that is at or slightly above your current stock price. Suppose you bought 1,000 shares of a $6.50 stock. You would select the October 7.5 strike price. Notice that there is a bid and an ask price. The current ask for BTGC, January 15, is 1.75, $1.75 a share. The current bid is 1.5, $1.50 a share. If you're a seller of the option, you want the ask price. If you're the buyer, you want the bid price. Because you've already selected one of the 2 stocks, determine how much you could receive by selling options on your stock if you got your bid price. Dr. Cooper's final decision before writing a covered call is to make sure that there are at least 50 contracts in the open interest column so that you can have a liquid market for your options. This helps you make the final decision. Odds are, depending upon the stock you pick, that you will win. If you do this 4 or 5 times a year, you'll probably get called out. be forced to sell your stock. About one time in four. You win three times, you lose once. Still, you're ahead by the end of the year, perhaps 20%, maybe 30% or more. You could also break even or even lose a bit. But with steady practice and dedication, you could improve your win-loss ratio. Dr. Cooper believes that using his unique covered call strategy increases the chances of finding the right option candidates with the lowest risk of failure. Profit multiplier 2, buying and selling call options. Until now, we've concentrated on the selling side of the equation, where you own the stock and are selling an option to someone else, writing covered calls. Now it's time to learn the power of being on the other side of the equation, the buying side. After I've gotten you accustomed to the advantages of selling options, where 80% of options expire without being exercised, then why would you want to risk being on the other side? What makes you think that you can be one of the lucky 20% who actually wins? It all depends on the stocks you select. What if your analysis shows that a stock has an excellent chance of increasing in value? If your research is right, you could double, triple, even quintuple your money. If you're wrong, you can lose 100% of your premium. When you buy an option, it's possible to make money in one of two major ways. Option profit method 1. You can make money from stock appreciation. In our previous example, Tom was the option buyer. He makes money if XYZ stock increases above the strike price. Of course, if the stock doesn't reach the strike price, he loses his entire premium. Option profit method 2. If you make money, you make money from the appreciation of the option itself. For example, ABC stock is selling for $17 per share. An option with a strike price of $20 with 3 months to expiration is selling for $1 per share. You buy one contract, 100 shares, and pay $100. As the underlying stock appreciates in value, the option also increases in value. The exciting part is that because of leverage, any appreciation in the stock price has a magnified effect on the option price. If a $20 stock goes up $1, a 5% increase, the option itself might increase in value from $1 to $1.50, a 50% increase. The options for which you paid $100 can now be sold for $150. That's a 50% profit. You can do this any time before the option expires. Just remember that an option is a wasting asset. It may increase in value in the short run, but unless exercised, it eventually becomes worthless. To make the most appreciation with minimized risk, you want to sell your options to someone else when there are at least 30 days left on the option. We will be focusing our attention on the second method. Our goal when buying options is to profit from the option itself and not from the underlying stock. We will be out of the option at least 30 days before it expires. Obviously, the rules for buying options are slightly different than for selling options. When writing covered calls, you want the exercise date to be as close to the current date as possible while still carrying a good premium. Thus, the stock is tied up for a shorter time and the annualized gain is larger. On the other hand, when you are buying options, you want to extend the time frame to at least 90 days to give your stock time to move up in value. Ironically, the filters we use to write covered calls, sell an option, are many of the same ones we use to buy options. But we're going to add a few extra cautions because we can make serious money only if the stock increases substantially above the strike price. If the stock goes nowhere, then our money evaporates. We don't like that thought. So the goal is to pick the hottest stocks that have the highest probability of increasing in value in the short run. Some weeks you will find 6 stocks, and some weeks there will be none. You want only those stocks that are priced above $50 a share. These stocks are more stable on the upside and less volatile on the downside. On a sample day, I found 4 stocks that filtered through our screens, and I placed them on my watch list. The question is, which of these stocks on the watch list has the greatest chance of increasing substantially in price in the short term? Dr. Cooper has tested various methods and determined that out of the hundreds of possibilities, he relies most heavily on 2 technical indicators. They are the 50-day moving average and the Williams percentage R technical indicator. Just knowing this information will save you hundreds of hours of trial and error, with an emphasis on error. The 50-day moving average. Let's look at the charts for these stocks and add a 50-day moving average. The 50-day simple moving average is calculated by taking the previous 50 days of closing prices, adding them up, and dividing by 50. This gives you an average daily price for the past 50 days. If the stock price is above the 50-day simple moving average, SMA, then there might be a tendency toward continued growth. When a stock price breaks below a 50-day SMA, there might be a tendency for the stock to continue to decline. A stock with an excellent 50-day SMA, trending nicely upward with few major dips and valleys, for a stock on your watch list to be considered further, you need an increasing 50-day moving average. The Williams Percentage R Indicator. Williams Percentage R is an indicator that tracks the overbought and oversold status of an individual stock. You'll also notice a solid line that cuts horizontally through this box. Let's call this line the neutral line. Some of the squiggly lines run above this neutral horizontal line and some drop below it. When the squiggly line is in the upper range above the neutral line, then the stock is overbought, meaning that there are more buyers than sellers. When the Williams Percentage R line drops to the lower range, below neutral, then the stock is oversold, meaning that there are more sellers than buyers. Since things tend to revert to the average, when a stock is in an extremely oversold condition, near the extreme bottom of the chart, there will be a tendency for it to bounce back. During this bounce back, the stock may move up in price. The Williams Percentage R is the final major screen. Each day, look at the stocks on your watch list and notice the pattern of the Williams Percentage R indicator. When it dips to the 90% oversold position, this is your preliminary buy signal. Table 7.6 shows how the filter chart looks. Dr. Cooper does his analysis each evening after the stock market closes. It takes about 30 minutes to scan through his watch list of about 50 stocks. He looks at the 50-day moving averages and the Williams Percentage R indicator. He selects the appropriate call option to buy at least 3 months and sometimes 5 months out in the future. He chooses the at-the-money strike price that is nearest to the current price that day. Then he notices the open interest activity on this particular option. Open interest refers to the number of contracts that are outstanding, which gives an indication of how many people are interested in this particular option. If this number is less than 50, he will not buy. He wants to buy those options with enough liquidity to allow a quick exit. If the open interest column is low, then there is a probability that he won't be able to sell quickly when he wants to sell. He feels even better if the open interest number is 100 or higher. All of these screens and filters make the process of trading much more scientific and much less emotional, and much more conservative. Because the screens are so restrictive, he makes only 1 to 2 trades per month. But each trade has a much higher probability of success. Having done his homework and being satisfied with his choice, Dr. Cooper waits until the next day before placing his order. He never buys during the first hour of trading. The market is subject to more volatility at the opening bell. He wants to wait until things settle down. Then if things still look positive, he makes his purchase. Once you have purchased an option contract, the most important decision still awaits: when to sell. Suppose you have taken a position in PQR stock with a strike price of $15 per share in 90 days. You bought 10 contracts at 75 cents quoted at 3/4 per share or $750. Depending on the movement of the stock, you need to know when to sell your options. All stock options should be sold 30 days prior to expiration, no matter what. Also, if the stock price ever dips below its 7-day moving average, this is a good time to take your profits and run. Scenario 1. The stock price increases to $18 per share. Because the stock price has increased, the option has most likely also increased in value. It may have gone from 3/4 to 1 3/4, giving you a full $1 profit. You could sell now and earn $1,000 profit on your 10 contracts, which represents a 133% return on your investment of $750. Or you could sell some of your contracts at this point to lock in your profit. Or you could let it ride. One of Dr. Cooper's money management strategies is to let the winners ride as much as possible. This is more difficult than it sounds. Dr. Cooper bought January options on Maytag, symbol MYG. The cost was $4 per share. Unfortunately, the market took an unexpected dive toward the end of August, and the options declined drastically in value. Dr. Cooper felt the underlying stock still had excellent value and, with several months remaining, decided to hang on. In his own words, "I had to ride this one out twice. It declined sharply by August 31st, then rallied to a peak on September 17th. There was then another steep market decline. It earned my 50% stop-loss limit on October 9th. One could have given up hope at this point, but at the darkest hour, the disciplined trader relies on the trading rules. With uncommon faith and rare courage, I held out, then sold on November 23rd at $10 for a profit of 150%. Scenario 2. The stock remains below the strike price. If the underlying stock isn't increasing in value, neither will the stock option. Actually, as time expires, the stock options begin to lose value. If at any time before the 30-day automatic selling date, your options lose 50% of their value of what you paid for them, you should sell them, take your losses, and move on. Some people have likened investing in options to gambling. For those who invest without a proven system and a powerful screening process, this may be accurate. But in one way at least, investing in options is completely unlike gambling. In gambling, if you bet on horse A and it gets a bad start out of the gate, you can't get your money back. But with options, if you select ABC company and it gets a bad start out of the chute, you can often sell your position and recoup at least part of your losses. With the careful selection process and wise money management, you can often cut your losses short and heighten your winners. A final word of warning about trading in the options market. Although I've given you enough information to broaden your understanding of a few of the strategies in the exciting but potentially dangerous world of options, you obviously need to do much more study before you commit any of your real dollars to this approach. Here are 6 rules. 1. Paper trade first. You should paper trade for at least 3 months. Never invest real money without a successful paper trading track record. 2. Never invest money you can't afford to lose. First, establish a survival fund. Then, commit 80% of your stock market funds to long and medium-term investment approaches. Consider options only for the short-term, high-risk portion of your portfolio. 3. Study, study, study. Your first place for free information about options is the website of the Chicago Board Options Exchange, www.cboe.com. Click on the education link, where you'll find plenty of free tutorials and some free software, the Options Toolbox. If you're a beginner, the tutorials here are a bit difficult to follow, but as you learn the lingo, you'll do fine. 4. Establish a mentoring relationship. Find someone who not only understands the world of options, but who consistently makes money trading in the real world, and pay them to teach you how to do it. The money will be well spent. Just one idea or strategy or money management system could pay for your tuition 100 times over. The best players in the world need coaches. Even the Lone Ranger had Tonto. Don't go it alone. You'll find some coaching options at www.multiplestreamsofincome.com. Keyword Cooper Coach. Don't overcommit. Investing in options can be exciting, but don't get too excited. Be prudent. Dr. Cooper's rules for money management will keep your enthusiasm in check. Commit no more than 25% of the funds in your high-risk bucket to any single trade if your account is under $25,000. If your account is over $25,000, commit no more than 10% on a single trade. Buy 5 contracts if your account is under $25,000. If your account is over $25,000, buy 5 or more contracts up to a dollar amount of no more than 10% of the account. Other experts insist on even tighter money management rules. Dr. Alexander Elder recommends risking only 2% of your available capital on any one trade. 6. Don't confuse brains for a bull market. Any system is going to look good during a bull market. When things go south, sit on the sidelines or return to paper trading. It may be that the system is not broken. Perhaps it's just not the right time to be trading with this system. Good luck in doubling your money. Recent comments about real trading and paper trading from some of Dr. Cooper's most recent Double Your Money Options Trading course. Thanks to selling covered calls option techniques I learned from Dr. Cooper, I just earned $593.75 in 1 month by selling 30-day calls on my AXA financial stock. This is equivalent to earning an annual rate of 25% interest on my money. Had I known of these techniques when I started buying stock over 7 years ago, I would be tens of thousands of dollars richer today. Reuben Wald, New York. Wow, Am I excited or what? My CPN contracts are up 234% in a month. The profits I made and am still earning on this one option have more than paid for your class, and we are still making more profits. I sold my GBLX position for a very nice profit as well last Friday. Joseph R. Rabia, Tampa, Florida. I didn't think I'd ever be able to make any money in the stock market. My first paper trade made 300%, and I'm averaging 99% overall on my paper trades. I'm really excited about the prospect of putting real money behind these trades, but I'm going to paper trade for 90 days, like Dr. Cooper taught us, before I invest any real money. Just follow the system and it will pay off. Diane Conklin, Stone Mountain, Georgia. I made $5,310, 157%, on Converse Technology October 75 calls using Dr. Cooper's option system. Thanks, Bob, Tom, and Dr. Cooper. John McGee.